Okay, Maestro, hit it.
I'm Wally Boat.
I didn't know you knew Mickey Mouse.
Museum of the Weird.
The dawn of a new era.
Just a dream away.
I do want to talk about going back to the characters you do know. So Country Bears, iconic Disney attraction, a Disneyland, unfortunately, removes it. Luckily saved still at Walt Disney World.
Thank goodness.
And that's one thing I will say that I do appreciate about Imagineers is they are very good about keeping one attraction, at least on one of the coasts. So we lost Muppet Vision in California Adventure, but we at least still have it at Hollywood Studios. So Country Bears, they're making a movie, one of the most iconic Disney attractions. Can you tell me a little bit about your work auditioning for the film and working on that film?
Oh, Country Bears. Oh, my goodness. Here's a movie that Jim Henson Studios brings me in and says, you're going to audition for the Country Bears. Pick a character. Here's the script. Pick a character. And I, of course, went for Big Al. Most of the puppeteers at Henson's went for Henry and Barry, and I went for Al. And I was at Disney Studios and they said, what are you going to read for? And I said, Big Al. And they went, Big Al. And I said, by your reaction, no one else is auditioning for Big Al. And they were like, Big Al, why Big Al? And I said, because he's the best character next. And I auditioned for him. And then I discovered what puppeteer, I always say I'm one of the top 10 puppeteers in the United States, or at least in Southern California. And I found out I was number 6 on that Richter scale because I was told I was going to be let go from the Country Bears project, that they needed to have one less puppeteer. They needed only 5. And so bye-bye to me. And I, to my shock and surprise, I cried. I was so sad that I wasn't going to be on it. I cried and I just couldn't understand what made them get rid of me. And really, they just needed 5. And so they came to me and Disney didn't, but the people at Henson said, we'll put you on another project, but you're not going to get that one. And I was really upset. And I said, why am I crying over the Country Bears? I like it, but I can't understand this reaction. And this was probably about April in the year that they were casting. And then just before Christmas, I got a call from Walt Disney Studios. And the gentleman said, where do I send your contract for the Country Bears? And I was like, what? And he said, you're Terri Hardin, right? And I said, yeah. And he said, I have a contract here for you to do the Country Bears movie. And I was like, are you punking me? And he's like, no. And I said, well, what characters am I playing? And he says, well, let me look. Big Al, really? And Trixie? I said, yeah. I said, could you just walk that over now before they change their mind? In case you made a mistake, could I come over and sign it right away? And he laughed and he said, no, I can assure you, you're on the show. I said, it's Terri Hardin, right? And I spelled my name. And he said, yes, Terri Hardin residing. And he said my address. And he said, Merry Christmas. Obviously, you didn't think you were on this film. I said, not only that, but they punted me off it. And he said, nope, you're on. And I ended up doing Big Al and Trixie. And it was one of the most fun films. We rehearsed. One of the challenges we had with Disney is Disney wanted to pre-record the voices. Mm-hmm. And as puppeteers, we went, oh, no, you don't want to do that. And Disney says, well, that's the way we work with animation. And we all said, we understand that's the way you work with animation. We are not animation. We are puppeteers. Mm-hmm. And if you pre-record the voices, we're locked into the voices. And therefore, you don't get any puppet magic. And they went, puppet magic? And he said, just because, see, you don't even know what it is. So don't lock us out of it. And they said, okay, all right, well, we feel we should lock you in. But what we'll do is we'll send you a voice and you perform one of your characters to that voice and then do it with what we call scratch track, which means we just do it and then the voices come in after and overdub it. So they chose Tennessee. And Tennessee was done by Julianne Buescher on the face articulation. So we have a joystick and we have a Waldo. We program it so that the face will work. On the joystick, you can have expressions like happy, sad, look left, look right, you know, whatever. And it's all here on a joystick with little buttons. And then here works the mouth. And it's all programmed on an audio animatronic head with servos, et cetera, et cetera. Builder is John Criswell, brilliant, brilliant, brilliant. And Julianne Buescher was the face and personality of the head. And then Jody, who's inside, is the body character creating all the body moves. And together they made Tennessee Bear. So it was the sequence that you all remember if you've seen Country Bears, where Tennessee is the marriage counselor.
Okay.
And they did it first to the voice. And the voice said, you know, I don't know why you want to do this because, you know, I just remember Trixie. Oh, Trixie, said the voice. But then we did the scratch track without the voice, and Jody and Julianne we rehearse walking, we rehearse sitting, we rehearse everything as a team, and we're connected by headsets. So Julianne looks at the script and she and Jody start to do it. And then she gets this idea. They get this idea. Trixie! Trixie! The voice didn't do this. This was Jody and Julianne. So how on earth, this is a magic puppet moment. Mm-hmm. And they don't come if we're locked into a voice. Animation, very different. Drawings to the voice, I get it. But with puppets, we are so twisted and wacky. We don't know until the characters come together and we have the script what we're going to do. And so it explodes. So with Big Al was so heavy. He had an 80-pound head that hung in front. And John Alexander, who you can see in Men in Black 1 and 2, he's the guy in the flying saucer in Men in Black 2, oh, okay, the crazy flying character. Mm-hmm. He's brilliant. He was in Gorillas in the Mist, one of most amazing suit performers. He's flown in from London to work Big Al because the suit is so heavy and the head is so heavy. And we came up with this little geisha walk because it was hard for him to walk in such a massive suit. So we came up with this geisha walk. I'm coming. Shuffle, shuffle, shuffle. I'll be right there. Shuffle, shuffle, shuffle. I'm coming. And people would just laugh. But in the final film, they would just do jump cuts where, you know, I'm fuzzy, but I'm fast or whatever he says, you know. So they would do it. They didn't let us do our shuffle, but our shuffle is what sold that character. Trixie being blonde and being with all of these brown bears, we, my dear friend Denise, inside the suit, me outside doing face, we had to create action to make Trixie not look dead, but we couldn't move very much because we were a blonde bear. And the minute we did anything, focus went to her because she's blonde. So we had to be, they kept saying less to us, less to us, less to us. And it got to the point where if we do any less, she's going to be dead. So Denise and I just kept working on little things we could do that wouldn't distract from the main team of bears when we did it. So when you're creating these characters, there's all kinds of elements. The Devil and Daniel Webster sequence that is it Zeb does with the violin. Who's inside the suit learned to play the violin. And what you don't understand about suit performers is we control the mouth on the outside. The only way they get air in is when we open the mouth, but we couldn't leave it open for the whole time. So we must time when they get air, and that's rehearsed. So Tony is busting a hump. If you watch that sequence, he's really playing. He's playing hard. And you can see the guy from Stray Cats after him is sweating. So imagine doing it in a big fursuit. And his puppeteer has to make sure that the mouth So air gets in so that Tony doesn't pass out, the performer, Tony Prince. So these are the things that are so incredible. If you look at Barry, played by Mindy, and Misty, who also was in Mandalorian as one of the characters, Misty runs the length of a full football field when she realizes Barry needs to go home. So we have spotters in the grass, and the puppeteer is doing little. So she's running with everything she's got. And the only way she can see is when the mouth is open. So you guys need to watch this film again, and you need to understand the magic that is created by these teams of characters that do these performances. We all work together as a huge unit to make it happen. And you may not have known it, it got cut from the film, not because it was bad, but because they didn't think it was necessary. Big Al did sing Blood on the Saddle.
There was blood on the saddle.
We sang it, we rehearsed it, we did it, we shot it, and we yodeled, and then they cut it. So,
which is the most iconic part of the attraction. You, when you leave Country Bear Jamboree, you're like, blood on the saddle. That is the one thing I remember.
It's Disney not looking at the fans. What do the fans want? And I really busted a hop working on it because I knew it was going to be probably the tag at the end because the fans loved it so much. And then at the end, they got rid of it. Also, at the end, when Al said, didn't want them standing on my grass outside. That sequence with the full on Country Bear Hall is full of Disney fans. So the director, Peter Hastings, was having some trouble with extras on the Country Bear movie. We were shooting at Disney Ranch, and the only way you can get on Disney Ranch is to do a movie. So I had all my fans writing, going, any chance we can get on the ranch? You know, Spin and Marty shot there, and they're listing all the things that shot there. And we'd really like to get there, but there's no way to get on there, and blah, 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 blah. And I was like, well, I'll keep my ears open, but I don't know. Well, the extras that they hire from like a casting agency, they didn't really take it very seriously. And they would either not show up or they would do things that were inappropriate. So Peter just said to us one day, I don't know how I'm going to get enough people to fill Country Bear Hall. And there I was. I do. He's like, what, Terry? And I said, why don't I just put a shout out via emails and Disney groups, and let's bring the Disney fans in for this final sequence. So the room is full of Disney fans, people who got to come. All they wanted to do was to see the ranch. They didn't even want to be paid. But they got paid. And then I had to talk them into cashing the checks. Josiah, take a picture and cash the checks or production is going to hurt you.
So, it has a Mickey on there.
It has a Mickey on there. It's a cute little pink check. And Mickey's going, hey, you got money. and they just had a ball. So if you slow it down at the end, you may recognize some of your friends because it is chock full of anyone that I could find that wanted to be a part of it. I invited to come and said, you know, they don't have a schedule. They're going to reach out to me and say tonight, and you guys are going to have like 4 hours to get to the ranch. So be ready, you know, be on your blocks, get ready, set, go. And I have a lady who drove probably a million miles an hour from Vegas just so she could be in the audience.
Oh, I would have 100% hopped a plane right away.
Yeah, everybody. And it was great because the third AD, which is an assistant director, he's the one that's in charge of the ensemble groups, said, these guys, Terry, you have done it. These guys are the nicest, sweetest, most fun people. And they want to be here because they love the film. They love the place. They love, he said, oh, I'm never going to forget. I said, you do another Disney film, just reach out to these people because they're all about the love of it. He said, this has just been, it was a pleasure for all of the production crew to work with these Disney people. And that's why I'm saying you don't want to look at these Disney people in any other way other than with caring and love, because you guys really make you made our jobs easier on Country Bears. And although they messed up by making it more about the people and less about the bears, because people started to diss it on social media, they started to make fun of it. And so Disney got scared and made it more about the actors and less about the bears. It was going to be all about the bears. And they switched it at the last minute because they were afraid no one would go see it. And as a result, no one went and saw it. But when it went to DVD, it became the number 5 top family film of that year. So it's still loved by so many. And I think people would have come and seen it if they hadn't put so much validity into social media, because, you know, people shouldn't diss something before they see it.
Absolutely.
And but it's got some great stuff. The audio animatronic bears are the best part. And it was a great opportunity to be a part of that film. And I love that movie.